My name is Stephen Perkins, and shout if you can't hear me, and if I make any mistakes or get things wrong, shout. So on the path through a few persons through a rather brief period of time, San Francisco between 80, 85, blah, blah, blah. I want to thank Pro Arts for inviting me to speak here and paying me. Although I'm slightly mortified to be described as a cultural icon, because that guy out there is the icon, I guess, whatever. But either way, when the invitation came, it reminded me that I was thinking not too long ago about how much great shit had happened in San Francisco in the 1980s, and I'd never heard of any gallery institution putting on an exhibit about this decade. So, but particularly for covering the underground and the San Francisco art scene, some of the other stuff has been covered. But for me personally, it was a fantastic and formative decade in which we all seem to be working individually and collaboratively across and between different media, with all of this sustained and enlivened by a strong and supportive artistic community, and most importantly, a gallery structure that was open to new and experimental work. In particular, I want to mention 88 in this respect, and I have to admit that I'm really surprised that it's still in operation. However, I can assume that it's still functioning as a laboratory for arty hipsters and others who are pushing the boundaries. I was there just yesterday with getting up the Great Hallway, and the place is in the front of the mess, and the toilets out on the street and everything, but it's incredible that it's still there after all this time, and I have to give kudos to Marshall and some of the people who organized that from the beginning. For myself, I took this artistic community for granted. It wasn't until I moved to Iowa City in 1990 to do a PhD in art history with an emphasis on artist periodicals that I realized how important community and the sense of solidarity that it offers is. After Iowa City, I moved to Green Bay, where I ended up running the University Art Gallery for the last 15 years. And each of these places, I tried to create situations and events through which an artistic community might hopefully coalesce. And one very specific example of this lowbrow do-it-yourself philosophy was the WC Gallery that I ran from 2003 to 2015 in a toilet just off the kitchen in our home in De Pere, a town just south of Green Bay. My wife was the co-curator as well. I did about two shows a year, and I always did little catalogs. Here we go. I want to get back. Okay. But I digress. Firstly, I want to offer my condolences with regard to the tragic events at Ghost Ship and in December. I can't really say anything else, but my condolences, the pain, I can totally understand. Other losses closer to home to the events that I'll be talking about are the following three incredible women. On the left is Lisa Swenson, filmmaker, teacher, a wonderful personality, and much more. I first met Lisa in 1981 when I hired her, along with Amy Elliott and Patty Davidson of the Media Gallery fame, if anybody ever remembers that gallery, to be my assistants in the San Francisco State Student Union Art Gallery. I got the job on a whim. I had it for a year. We just had the most incredible time. We put on all sorts of really great stuff, and these women were fantastic. The woman in the middle, Ada Ishkanian, a videographer, textile artist, art teacher, born in Egypt of Armenian heritage, and one of the early board members of ATA, and my wife, who died in Egypt in a car accident south of Cairo while doing an art residency with contemporary Egyptian artist Mohammed Abou. On the right, Laura Broom. She attended San Francisco State. She's an artist, performance artist, and artistic director of the lab from 1989 to 2004, and then later an arts administrator. I haven't seen Laura or Lisa for probably about 25 years, but no, it's just three.
Did she die?
But
she died.
Yeah, about 3-4 months ago.
I think it was in May or June last year.
Wasn't it?
Lisa died a few months before.
Okay, I'm getting my dates wrong. Either way, a real loss, and these women were both important in terms of the events that I'm going to be describing. One of the reasons I ended up in San Francisco in 1980 from the UK in the first place was because my application to the history of photography program at the University of New Mexico at Albuquerque was rejected. My second choice was San Francisco State, and the draw there for me was John Collier Jr., this guy, who was instrumental in creating the field of visual anthropology. He was a challenging teacher in spite of the fact that he was almost totally deaf. With him, I pursued my interest in family photo albums, which was also the topic that I wrote my MA thesis on. Collier's approach to photography strongly influenced me ever since in ways that I'm still absorbing in my own photographic practice. Either way, I owe him a great debt, as well as his anthropologist son, Malcolm Collier, who was my thesis advisor. Another person I just want to mention is Gustav Metzger. His dates were 1926 to 2017, and I think he died 3 months ago. He was the third documented individual who called from art strike between 1977 and 1980, but unfortunately it was a complete flop, as Metzger was unable to find any other artists to strike with him. Metzger was the founder of autodestructive art, and here he is spraying hydrochloric acid on nylon canvas, which started to corrode immediately upon impact in a demonstration at South Bank in London in 1961. Metzger was also one of the organizers of the Destruction in Art Symposium, DIAS, which was held in London from September 9th through the 11th, 1966, and was attended by a diverse group of artists, poets, and scientists, and attracted the attention of both the international media and members of the international art community to the symposium. So a very important gathering. So Gustav Metzger, Wolf Estelle, Al Hansen, important fantasized, and Yoko Ono. Yoko Ono, for me, her breakthrough when it came out in 62, well, just blew me away. I mean, she's a really incredible artist, despite all the shit she's been given. Just right on. So this talk is going to be a mixture of personal account, description of events and outcomes of and about the various projects that I was involved in, that I was involved in as an organizer with others in the San Francisco art community between 85 and 90. And I shall also be describing some of my own works from this period, as well as including photos of mine from assorted events that were happening locally and internationally to help set the larger context for this period. For those of you in the audience who are involved in these events I'm describing, feel free to correct any dates, as I just said, that I get wrong. After all, I'm describing events and situations that occurred over 30 years ago, and as anyone in the audience who is approaching the late 50s or early 60s knows, things do seem to get a little foggy when one tries to actually describe events from that period. No doubt the ingestion of certain smokable materials then and now have probably contributed this slight amnesia. the bombing of the invasion of Grenada, the Marines bombed in Beirut, and then obviously when I came to San Francisco, the whole damn white thing and the Harvey Milk issue that was just a current, and there was a countdown on Castro Street as to when Dan White was going to be freed. I think he lasted about a year before he committed suicide. I can't remember the story. And I was sort of documenting events, and this only in retrospect I realized was the first AIDS candlelight vigil in San Francisco. So it was a sort of important kind of coalescing of people and communities around for AIDS. Obviously, that's a sort of underlying theme to this whole decade. My story really starts with a trip back to the UK. This was a piece I did. I was doing kind of street stuff. The Xerox machine for me was just the most incredible thing. I mean, it was the thing that we could create posters with, things that we could create zines with, all sorts of stuff. So and with a neighborhood of Xerox stores, I mean, you could go in any time and you could crank out stuff. So for my community I was a part of, the Xerox machine was really important. So here's a piece I did on AIDS and men This is another piece that published in a magazine, but it was another flyer that I put out there. My story really starts with a trip back to the UK to visit family in the summer of 1985. And on my last day there, I met up with Stuart Holme, cultural critic, novelist, former Neoist, and art striker, and probably other people have their own opinions about Stuart Holme, I'm sure. And as we founded company in central London, he exhorted me to adopt the name Karen Elliott as my artistic identity and to publish a magazine called Smile. While I was reluctant to give up my individuality to a project I knew little about, I was nonetheless intrigued by his proposal. As a result of this encounter, and from my return to the USA, I adopted the name Janet Janet for one of my cultural activities. And between 1985 and 1989, she published texts and visual works by the international through the International Correspondence Art Network, including a 30-day male marriage of Norman Conquest. And it was at this point that the whole working under a different kind of identity got kind of a bit scary, because Norman was a pretty grand kind of guy, and I never met him in person with that. Soon, however, she was invited to participate in performances and readings, and so I cajoled various friends to be her for these occasions. And the first one first time Janet was, in fact, Ada Ishkanian, who would turn out to be my wife, and this was a way, one way I was sort of connected with her and kind of very sort of flirtatious, and this was the beginning of our relationship. And then April Jones was the second one, and the third one was Nathan Irizarry. From 1985 to 89, she also published 14 issues of Schism magazine. And the name Schism was chosen from a reference by Stuart Holmes to splits and schisms in his 1985 open letter to the Neoist Network, the published at large, which documented his break with the Neoists after returning from the 9th Neoist Apartment Festival that was held in Pontenosa, Italy. As a result of these connections, as well as Schism's oblique similarity to the word smile, Schism is considered to be part of the Smile Publishing Project and was included in the National Art Library's 1992 show of around 94 different smiles published by some 40 editors across 9 countries at the Victorian Albert Museum. Janet ceased all activities at the beginning of the art strike in 1990. The idea that different people would perform or publish under the same name came to be known as the multiple name concept, and it was one of the strategies adopted by the late 20th century art movement, Neoism. So yeah, these are just some of the smile, and you see people took liberties with the title. I collected as many as I could, and they all varied in various sort of individual ways. I also did my dissertation on artist periodicals, so smile was definitely sort of a part of that, and a very, very sort of interesting publication. What is Neoism? Who is Neoism, and why Neoism? The received myth of Neoism's beginnings takes place with the initial 1976 encounter in Budapest between David Zak, an American writer and correspondent and male artist, and István Kántor, a Hungarian medical student and aspiring pop singer. During the conversations, Zak outlined his proposal for the creation of an open pop star. This name would be Monty Canson. A year later, Kántor emigrated to Montreal and subsequently visited Zak, who at that time was living in Portland, Oregon. This visit confirmed Kántor's new identity as Monty Canson, open pop star, and soon after returning to Montreal, he formed that Neoist movement. Although Kántor is the individual most closely identified with the Monty Canson name, the open pop star concept was premised upon the multiple name concept, that is, multiple people using the same name for their creative activities. By utilizing the Monty Canson name, I mean, it still will be operational if anybody wants to take it up. Anyone can participate in expanding the collective identity of Monty Canson, save themselves the time and money and effort involved in establishing their own artistic identity, and at the same time further the cause of Neoism. Simple, really. So this is the Monty Canson's Neoist manifesto. Well, of course, it's an anti-art movement, so we don't have a manifesto, but of course, we have to have something like this. Defining Neoism, or indeed classifying it, is to encounter its paradoxical nature. Quite literally, Neoism means new-ism, which establishes its modernist avant-garde lineage, positions it as something that is always in the process of becoming, and establishes its refusal to commit to any formal or theoretical decisions with which to achieve its aims. One Neoist has described Neoism as, quote, a movement to create the illusion that there's a movement called Neoism, end quote. Kántor, when pressed for a definition of Neoism in 1993, replied, I have thousands of definitions, but none of them are good for anything, and perhaps always the newest one is the best. On the beginnings of Neoism, Kántor replied, the birth of Neoism took place as follows. There was a name, and I said, let's give it a try, and whatever comes out, we'll call it Neoism. Contrary to Neoism's etymological basis in newness is its refusal to generate new objects or ideas. Neoism's strategy is one of appropriating previously extant activities and ideas as its own. Cantor elaborates on the signature characteristic of Neoism when he says, it uses ready-made ideas, it does not necessarily have to invent a form, but the form that has already been used can be reused by Neoism and turned into something else. If you look at the principles of Neoism, actually, you can immediately see that inventions are old and boring. The Neoists don't want to invent things. The Neoists want to apply things better than anyone else. Originality, uniqueness, and the term new are not what's important anymore. What isn't is important is that we completely recycle all the ideas that already exist as if somebody had recycled the whole of the 20th century. It's really simple. Monty has a habit of taking his blood and contributing to exhibitions, and he usually puts a cross with a vial of his blood, and almost always he's taken out and bound. So he's a sort of confronted character. Stuart Holland was also interested in recycling previously used ideas, in particular the idea of the avant-garde and the critiques of the institution of art. In the letter that marks his break with the Neoists, he wrote, quote, my approach to art, life and politics has not changed. I simply feel it's no longer feasible for me to be a Neoist. Splits and schisms, are essential to my conception of Neoism, and any public slang match between an ex-Neoist and the remaining members of the movements is worth 12,000 great works of art. Ultimately, what all Neoists should aim for is an acrimonious split with the movement. To leave Neoism is to realize it. Hegel's. Neoism's paradigmatic avant-garde split with Holmes' paradigmatic avant-garde split with Neoism took place on a number of different levels. Frustrated over the Neoist strategy that deliberately obscured this anti-art movement's aims, Holmes wanted to introduce a clarity in its theoretical position and situate it with historical precedence. To do the former, he linked Neoism with Situationism and Fluxus, two post-World War II groups that he felt constituted part of his century's utopian current. And for the latter, he made a historical connection explicit when he wrote that, quote, Neoism is an illegible note that Tristan Tzara allowed to fall from his breast pocket prior to a performance at the Cabaret Voltaire in 1916. At the same time, Holm used the split to position himself as the architect of a rehabilitated Neoist avant-garde, one that would be constructed in such a way that it could successfully be introduced in the historicization process. A critical component of this strategy was his insight into the pivotal role that text played in the construction of avant-garde movements. Holmes states that, when I looked back at the Neoists, I thought certain aspects of the movement were underdeveloped. For example, there wasn't enough text. That was the one of the things I wanted to introduce in vast quantities. As a result of this lack, the Neoists were in danger of losing their avant-garde identity and becoming just another part of the underground. While its members were madly documenting their events, there had been a failure to grasp the central role that written reports played in the process of historicization. Stuart Holmes' book, Assault on Culture, 1988, was a really important book for me because he was the first person I'd come across who was really looking at some utopian underground tendencies of avant-garde art stuff and things that people had never really written about. So this was really rich stuff for me and for others. As a result, Holmes renewed his original call for the use of Smiles' multiple name in the context of periodical publishing, and in a direct challenge to Cantor proposed the name Karen Elliott as a counter-multiple name. With the implementation of these two strategies, Holmes cemented his split with Neoism, and through the promotion of Smile as an international magazine of multiple origins, created a mechanism for the collective production of vast quantities of printed matter. I think anybody who's looked at data realizes that printed matter and text are really key elements in the construction of any kind of avant-garde. And that was Holmes, I think, sort of a pretty smart insight. So he set about doing it and relatively successful, I would have thought. So these are some of his smiles. For David Zack, the author of the multiple name concept, it was a strategy through which, quote, people can share their art power. For Cantor and Holm, it was a form of collective resistance to the construction of the individual. Cantor. By giving the same name to different people, we create a kind of confusion that makes control impossible. Because everybody has the same name, there is no control possible. For whom, it is in power's interest that each individual has a unique name, thus making them easily identifiable. Without these classifications, power cannot control, because it cannot differentiate, divide, and isolate. Thus, multiplicity was seen by the nihilists as a way of thwarting capitalism's construction and reification of the individual, and the means through which to create a non-hierarchical and collectively constructed identity. Implicit in this position is a critique of a string of related concepts recognized by both Cantor and Hohn that are associated with the construction of the individual and valorized under capital. Some of these are genius, originality, artist, author, producer, owner, and copyright. While recognizing the reason important features of the multiple name concept and integral to Neoism's position, I want, however, to turn my attention to Hohn's role in the application of this concept. I would suggest that Hohn's active promotion of the use of multiple names of individuals and periodicals was another key element in his avant-gardization of Neoism, and that through this double application of the multiple name concept, he was able to influence how and in what manner Neoism would be manifested, and equally importantly, how it would be documented. In fact, I think for Hohn it's the historical project from the very beginning, not only writing in Neoism, but writing himself in a historical record. Furthermore, it was only through the activation of the multiple name concept and the establishment of a collective identity that Neoism could be perceived as an avant-garde movement. Multiple names gave a collective form to the formlessness at the center of Neoism. And Hohn's investment in this strategy is clear. If Neoism was not perceived as an avant-garde movement, then his plans for subjective historicization would not take place. One of the ostensible reasons for Hohn's split with the Neoists was his observation that István Cantor had become over-identified with Monte Cassin and was therefore diminishing the revolutionary potential of this strategy. Cantor himself suggests that this critique was substantially correct in the following statements. Because I was the first person to become Monte Cassin, I created the name Neoism. I was completely beholden by it, and I put all my life and energy into it. This Monte Cassin job is one of the most difficult ones I've ever got, and it's not easy to accomplish it and balance the fictive and real parts. This over-identification on Cantor's behalf gave Hohn added incentive to insert his own multiple name, Karen Elliott, into the Neoist context. For Hohn, multiple names were to be approached as open contexts, as situations rather than jobs. And here's a quote from Hohn. Karen Elliott is a name which refers to an individual who, human being, doesn't mean anyone. The name is fixed, the people using it aren't. Anyone can become Karen Elliott by adopting the name, but they are only Karen Elliott for the period in which the name is used. Karen Elliott is materialized rather than born as an open context in the summer of 1985. When one becomes Karen Elliott, one's previous existence consists of the acts other people have undertaken using the name. The Karen Elliott open context generated a substantial amount of text and actions in her name, as well as revitalizing the use of Monte Cassin. It is interesting to note that although Hohn put forward Karen Elliott as an other to counter Monte Cassin, there was no discussion on his behalf or the others around issues of gender. The flaming steam iron is a Neoist symbol used quite often. At the same time as I was starting the Janet project, I started an art magazine called Box of Water, which ran for four issues from 1985 to 1988, as I was now involved in the International Correspondence Art Network, and much of the work of the magazine came from this source. Once you start publishing a magazine, or start a gallery for that matter, you become a nexus of activity and develop contacts with people from all over the world. And eye-opening experience for me. It also made me realize that no one had really written about these publications across borders with art magazines, art magazines, and zines and the little magazine scene. So this is what really sort of stimulated me to develop it further in some academic context, because no one had really written about this material. Just want to show some photographs. Maybe some of you had got up at Emeryville Mud Flats, created sculptures and protests, etc., etc. So I just want to sort of set it once again, kind of larger scene. And Then there was a demonstration at Concord Naval Weapons Station, and a train loaded with weapons to South America ran over one of the protesters of Brian Wilson, and he lost both his legs in a very sort of tragic accident, incident, whatever. And we went out 3 days later, we took up trials, which is a really powerful feat. This is another work of mine. This is in reference to a group called Food Not Bombs, who were giving out free food in Golden Gate Park, and got the attention of the cops. I had no reason to understand why. So this was my response to what's happening there. And here we have them giving out food in the Golden Gate Park, and then we have a little police action. But back to my story. In a letter I received from home sometime in 1987, he wrote, "I should really tell you more about the Festival of Plagiarism, but I just get really bored continually writing to people about it. So far, there's 5 exhibitions confirmed over a 2-month period, January and February 1988, with at least a couple more looking like they'll come off. The idea is to present a challenge to the viewers of the art establishment. It's about accessibility, self-organization, the redundancy of postmodernism, and the fact that the only language we can now speak is that of the media. So rather than trying to create new languages, which is futile, we should alter the dominant language to suit our own needs. Thus, we use the idea of plagiarism to counter that of originality and genius, and the fact that we are born in a culture and have to work with what is already there. We can alter things, but can't make a clean break. Plagiarism, of course, is a good wind-up word, and it's been used to put across the idea in media fashion. It's a very particular use of the word, but we chose to use it because it is because of its impact, shock value, to reflect the way that media speak distorts everything anyway. Well, it'd be nice to get you involved in some way." This was a critique of our original flyer for the Plagiarism Festival, and this is from a Berkeley sit. And it's actually one of the smartest critiques of what we're doing, and particularly takes us at issue with our poster and our use of a copyright symbol without negating it in any way. The only thing that kind of, for me, undermines his whole position is that he's called himself a professor and marked it out at the bottom, so he's adopted a kind of authority that would come with being a professor, and yet he's doing a sort of anti-authoritarian critique. If he's here right now, so this was one of the smartest takes on our original publicity. The environment amongst the art community of artists that I was a part of was very receptive to the idea of a festival of plagiarism. And we had a long series of meetings at the home of Minette Lehman in the latter part of 1987 to discuss the possibility of doing something in San Francisco. All sorts of people attended these meetings, and the conversations were wide-ranging as we discussed all the ramifications, both theoretical and practical, with regard to how we understood plagiarism, as well as the logistics of organizing a festival. Naturally, we produced huge amounts of publicity and text, and coupled with the material from other festivals of plagiarism that took place both in the USA and the UK, we were swimming in stuff. This is a number of different publications, different artists within the States developed over plagiarism. Top left is actually the sort of catalogue that Stuart Home produced in anticipation of the Festivals of Plagiarism, so it was a kind of whole series of texts that we could really get our teeth into. The festival finally took place from Friday, February the 5th to Sunday, February the 7th at ATA, with our publicity promising, quote, "a continuous 50-hour polymedia celebration of plagiarism as a positive artistic technique with live performance, theater, video installations, video art, poetry, lectures, audio installations, etc., etc., workshops, and audience participation." So these are just some of the publicity. Lloyd Dunn, based in Iowa City, very much a part of this whole movement, and also a publisher, went over to the Festival of Plagiarism in Glasgow, did some publicity for those guys. These posters are up in the wall here by Laura Brun, some of the most really, really sweet posters, and I'm pleased that we were able to get them into the show. And then there's a sort of little card. Yeah, so plagiarism saves time, Andy Warhol. Plagiarism is taking back what was stolen from us in the first place, like Kosky. Plagiarism, the End of Commodity Culture. So, I mean, yeah. So then this is the flyer for the first real event for the Festival of Plagiarism was an event organized at KPFA by Tom Patrick. He had a radio show called Over the Edge, so we went in and did a plagiarism a version of that. The festival commenced with an opening reception with live performances by various artists, and later in the evening a performance by SKP of Carolee Schneemann's 1964 Meat Job. A group of us went over to Berkeley to the Plagiarist radio show, blah, blah, blah. Festival attendees were encouraged to stay overnight, and as I remember it, Arvind Ishkanian and I slept in the front window of ATA that night. And I distinctly remember Martin Cox coming up to me the next morning, all excited, and telling me that as he walked past the gallery that night, he'd see my balls as I was sleeping there. Well, apart from a little embarrassment, I survived, and presumably all the other pedestrians who dared look in the window did as well. However, there was plenty of nudity during the rest of the weekend. Yeah, this is SKP doing Carolee Schneemann's media. Free tattoos, Amy Elliott, and God, I can't remember what his name is. Arvind Ishkanian on the left. She used to dress as a nun every now and again and walk around the mission and have all these incredible experiences. Tom Patrick on the right in dark glasses. The gallery was covered all over with art, including the basement, so it was an ever-changing smorgasbord of text, images, and whatever could affix to the walls. Final gesture was Sigurd's recreation of Leonardo's Last Supper, along with an original art auction and a plagiarist swap. But one of the things, the big feature on Saturday was a panel discussion with an assortment of distinguished panelists, as you can see here, moderated by Aaron Blake. My memories of this panel are now hazy, but I have a distinct recollection that Marshall Weber, a little shit, sabotaged any meaningful discussion with his typically loquacious manner, insisted on taking time and space to heck all and sundry on his negative critique of plagiarism and the festival itself. As you can see, fading memories notwithstanding, there's always space in memory banks for old grudges, as if they were yesterday and this one is 29 years old. I just remember him being pissed off. He really cut, diminished the discussion, and he has some really bright people, so it still ranks as a So anyway, so I use this to get my advice. Responsibility for organizing the festival fell on the shoulders of Scott McLeod, Laura Brown and myself, but it was also equally shared by a large group of people who stepped up to the plate to do whatever was needed as the weekend progressed. In fact, I distinctly remember how people self-selected themselves to assume responsibility when the occasion rose and to do all the hundreds of little things that needed to be done. It was truly a collective effort. The cost of to get into the festival was $3 per day, and a full festival pass was $5. After splitting the door with ATA, we realized $912 from a total of $1,824. And after deducting our expenses of $684, we had a net profit of $228, with which we produced a catalog the next year documenting the festival. Someone in the front door, front window. There's music things going on. Someone trying to organize something, plagiarize photographs, Sigurd's Arenas, Petit Déjeuner, the never poet on the right. So this is Torinus's Leonardo's Last Supper, which was what the sort of culminating event of the weekend. So for me, documentation of this event is really important, since otherwise the whole event could easily sink into obscurity. And as Stuart Hearn remarked, quote, producing adequate documentation of activities is a crucial part of the cultural process. If the hegemony of dominant culture is to be successfully challenged, then those who oppose it must act on this fact. In my essay about the festival in the catalogue, I address what it was we were hoping to create through it, writing, quote, I would characterize our goals as the creation of a continuous 50-hour open situation that consciously set out to resolve the performance-audience separation through the creation of a total environment. a situation that made it hard for those attending not to become its participants as well. Within this polymedia, time-based, and inclusive environment, we hope to focus attention on the many issues that plagiarism raises, with particular emphasis on received ideas about the role of the artist, artistic identity, inspiration, influence, and originality. So, here's my ancient map that when I left Iowa City to go up to Green Bay for my first job, a curating job, I left in the public dump, and I can still see it, because I couldn't do anything with it. In my essay about the festival, the catalogue, I address what it was we were hoping to... And in this text, I also address our relative failure to address any issues raised by the whole problem of plagiarism in any substantial manner, and how we have been perhaps too optimistic that this would happen in a festival environment. However, I concluded that it was at the experiential level that the festival was the most exciting and successful, stating, as it proceeded, it became clear that a temporary and autonomous cultural milieu was being created and sustained by our participants, coupled with the free flow of people within the gallery space and simultaneous activities occurring in all these areas, there was almost palpable festival atmosphere which continued throughout the 50 hours. Much of the upbeat energy seemed to be generated by the sense that the festival belonged to everyone who was there, that it was an inclusive and continually changing process with no ostensible bosses or curators, and that what did or did not happen was very much dependent on people's participation or non-participation. So if some of our loftier goals were not attained, the festival did at least confirm for me that given such an open situation, people are quick to sense the possibilities and responsibilities of this kind of milieu. And further, that once people are giving back the power to directly shape and influence their immediate environment, a wave of collective creativity is unleashed. A couple of years later, I came across Hakeem Bey's Peter-Lambert Wilson concept of TAS, and it just hit me because that's what we created, a totally kind of autonomous moment. And he described it beautifully. He's talking about pirates and their pirate locales, but it was exactly what I hoped to create. And so it was really interesting to have that put in words. In fact, Peter-Lambert Wilson, Hakeem Bey, very interesting guy. Here we are in a meadow in the Driftless region of southeast of Wisconsin, southwest Wisconsin, absolutely beautiful, and he's standing in this environment fucking reading. Anyway, very interesting guy. Even though the depth of discussions around plagiarism during the festival and in our planning meetings very tremendously and was very much dependent on people's familiarity with all the issues it embraced, as well as whether they had devised their own critique of the art world and the art's place within this nexus of institutions that shapes our thinking about the art world, the experience proved to lay a fertile ground for the next large-scale project that we took on in San Francisco. Simply put, and as I look back at this contemporary moment, the Festivals of Plagiarism were really the Trojan horse that introduced the art strike 1990 to 1993. There have previously been a number of different initiatives that served as a history of previous attempts to do the same. Between 1960 and 1990, there were six initiatives that provided the seedbed for our project. And I'll just go through these very briefly. John Kennedy, in an article in New York Times, discusses a letter he received from a, quote, notoriously conservative painter who died in 1905, quote, in which he suggests that on Labor Day, all artists stop producing and all galleries close in order to, quote, give the art situation a chance to come into balance. And this moratorium runs into difficulties when legal measures might be introduced to implement it. Alain Joffre, a French writer, called for an art strike a couple of months after the failed uprising in Paris. And this call was part of his larger call for the abolition of art, something that he'd been calling for prior to the events in Paris. The New York art strike came into being on Monday, May the 18th, 1970, at NYU's Lieb Student Center during a mass meeting of more than 100 to 1,000 members of the arts community in response to the recent invasion of Cambodia and the killing of four students at Kent State University. Other art strike initiatives included the short-lived International Coalition for the Liquidation of Art, formed in Amsterdam in the summer of 1970, who, after issuing a manifesto, disappeared without trace. I've spoken already about Gustav Netz's call for an art strike between 1977 and 1980, in which he stated, quote, the refusal of labor is the chief weapon of workers fighting the system. Artists can use the same weapon. To bring down the art system, it is necessary to call for years without art. When artists will not produce, sell work, permit work to go on exhibition, and refuse collaboration with any part of the public city machinery of the art world. This total withdrawal of labour is the most extreme collective challenge that artists can make to the state. In 1979, Doran Dodovic, a Yugoslavian, circulated a similar proposal to an international roster of artists, seeking the response to a possible call for an international strike of artists. He received replies from approximately 40 artists, and he summarized their replies writing that, quote, "The majority of artists expressed their reserve to this idea or doubt to the possibility of its realization, but there were positive answers too. Mel Ranscombe, a conceptual artist and member of the Art Language Group, mirrored the concerns of money when he wrote, quote, I don't have the financial flexibility to boycott. By late fall of 1988, we were having meetings and discussions in earnest, all while producing huge amounts of texts and posters publicizing the idea of an art strike in order to inform people of the issues and in order to gain support for the idea. As one can imagine, many people were deeply threatened by the idea of not making art and wondering what on earth they would do if this came to pass. So we produced even more materials tackling these questions head on. And in one in particular came in the form of a manifesto titled 20 of the Most Difficult, Awkward, Searching Questions You Could Have Asked About the Art Strike, 1990-1993. So some selections illustrate the general tenor of our position. What art will be struck is the question. Art strike is an assault upon all cultural activity within the modernist and postmodernist traditions. Is this a joke? Absolutely not. How can you have shows when some people don't even have shoes? What's wrong with being an artist? To call one person artist is to deny another the equal gift of vision. Is this a joke? Sure, a joke, a fraud, the worst idea ever. Will sex be better during the art strike? Goes without saying. As part of the organizing for the art strike, we formed the Art Strike Action Committee in parentheses, California, and this model was taken up by others in the USA, UK, Europe, and Latin America who are participating in the call. As an aside to this organizing, I was horrified to discover that as part of their planning for the Holocaust, the Nazis also developed what they called action committees. However, in our case, it was a convenient form that was quickly replicated by other art strikers, and it gave the whole effort a kind of bureaucratic imprimatur that disguised the wide range of opinions that different members held. From our discussions during our meetings, we decided to hold an art strike mobilization week from January 3rd to the 8th, 1989. This week would serve as a propaganda tool in which we would further educate ourselves and others about the issues entailed in this call, in preparation for giving up at the stroke of the 1990th New Year. Plus, we wanted to have some fun as well. Once again, ATA provided the location, and I can't emphasize how important it was to have a space like ATA that was flexible enough, welcoming, centrally located, and most importantly, affordable for our group of starving artists. Something struck me here. I kind of so we had a propaganda night, and we provided all the materials, and we had a whole bunch of stuff. We Xeroxed them, and then we went out that evening and put them all around town. So this is where the Xerox machine becomes totally key. This was again Janet Schism, number 20, in which she used a survey from a Yugoslavian artist actually, and circulated this as a kind of Stuart Homer published a catalog handbook in preparation for the art strike, and then later. Just into the art strike, he published the art strike papers. Yawn was a really great publication, came out of Iron City, Lloyd Down, that ran for a number of years throughout the art strike, almost through the end, and he really covered it in perhaps probably the sort of most detailed, just a double-sided single sheet. He worked in the University of Iowa Photocopy Center. So he produced a lot of shit. You know, all the little things. Can Andre go to us? Dear Art Strike Action Committee, congratulations on furthering cause of capitalism. The drive of advanced capital proletarianizes the primitive capitalists. The Luddites broke machines because they did not want to become wage laborers. Wage labor only for all artists. Up the rich, all artists in sweatshops. Let no worker own his own production. Carl Andre.
He killed his wife.
Let's not get into that, because that's not But the little design underneath California 94117 obviously raises a reminiscence to his floor pieces. Artists dancing in anticipation of the abstract sculpting, as you said there. In fact, whole slew of people, really interesting people. Looking at my, Tuesday was the art strike, the propaganda week. Tuesday was art strike, everything you need to know. Wednesday was the propaganda night where, as I was talking about, we created works. Thursday was titled Picking Your Scabs, Licking Your Wounds, Support, Opposition, Testimonials. Friday night was Date Night, 2000 Years of Foreplay. Saturday was the Pagan Paradise, Sex and Death in the Years Without Art. And Sunday was the Morning After and the Closing Reception. Looking at my notes from this week, it is clear that it struck a responsive chord. We had around 50 people on Tuesday with lots of questions, with one participant observing that on the surface, the art strike would seem to limit things, but when you really begin to take away the label art, your activity, which will be what happens, it in fact broadens the field of activity into a lot of different areas that the term actually, art actually excludes. The Wednesday propaganda night attracted about 25 to 30 people who made liberal use of the materials we provided, as I described. So this was a little brochure we put together for the beginning of that week, with each night and little quotes that hopefully would stimulate people to get involved and explore the different themes we were looking at. And of course, if you're a plagiarist, I mean, you can get anybody in the world saying the most ridiculous things because you just make fuck up. It's great, so we had a lot of fun. I've got a little ahead of myself here. Friday night was Date Night. Minette Lehman, who really played a very kind of interesting role, professor at San Francisco Island student, I think, at that time. She was just very good at getting people to talk. And she'd be teaching, so she had a real facility. So on Friday, the Date Night, Minette Lehman got the ball rolling with free-willing discussion in a semi-lecture format. In my notes, I write that it wasn't until a couple of people tried to leave, and she pleaded with them to stay, that somehow something gave way, and what followed was some of the most interesting discussions we had. I noticed a theme of the discussions in which people voiced a sense that somehow the intimacy of artistic exchange within our community had been lost, and the art strike in some way was a response to this loss. Later, Scott McCloud graciously introduced his predicament of having conned a swing band from East Bay to come over and play for free, and they wanted to play now. Scott then did his shady reading piece while the band and two go-go dancers did their thing in the background. And I wrote that I left that evening feeling very exhilarated by the whole thing and full of excitement about the potential of the whole project. At the same time, in 1990, obviously, sixth International AIDS Conference, where we basically shut down the city because of all the kind of politics and all the issues about sort of developing medication and all that kind of stuff. And so these were pretty wild times when, during that conference. And then at the same time, the final push against apartheid in South Africa was a really hot topic in San Francisco at that time. The Art Strike Mobilization Week was one of the last series of formal activities of the Art Strike Action Committee organized until the end of the year loomed up, and we coordinated a gigantic 24-hour Art Strike liquidation sale again at ATA from Saturday, December 30th to Sunday, December 31st. And here's a summary. This was incredible when Mandela and Winnie came to Oakland Auditorium within the same year after he'd been released. I don't know if any of you guys were there. This was just fantastic.
Is that the Coliseum?
this is a policy. My wife and I, we got it for free because we were ushers, but just the whole thing was just fantastic. So yeah, this is the outright liquidation, the final sort of efforts. And as part of that, we collected a whole lot of materials and we created a time capsule. So here we are, Hugh Pocock, got in some machinery and took out cement. We dug a hole, Aaron Noble. Aaron Noble was a really key player in this whole thing, very important guy. But this activity allowed him to share his stockings. Adish Khan in the hole, it was sort of quite big at this point. This space is now totally packed with Craig Baldwin's films. I mean, you need to be able to find it. Todd Edelman, I don't know if Todd's here, he was also another key player in this whole event. Here we are getting rid of art for the liquidation sale, and I can't remember if we sold it in the end. I'm sure we couldn't even give away most of it because it was total crap. Okay, so just a little summary of the liquidation we had, that I wrote at that time. We had a small crowd than hoped for the Art Strike Bash, but it was fun nonetheless. In the window of the gallery, we had some continuous video editing lessons, mixing the video stuff taped minutes before to Art Strike tapes from earlier this year. An Art Strike computer questionnaire coupled with computer graphics, a continuous Super 8 film being cut and edited by participants from found footage. Final film was 5 minutes long. Art Strike tarot readings, remarkably accurate. An opportunity to have yourself photographed with a famous curator, artist, art world personality. And one large evolving collaborative painting and a copious propaganda table. When the 24 hours were up, we put all this material into the Art Strike time capsule, including video, Super 8, underdeveloped film, final video mix, the painting, propaganda, and the tarot cards. Filled in the hole and went off to celebrate the new year. And so I was in Iowa City when the strike really began. For me, it was pretty easy to be on strike in an urban situation in San Francisco, but once I got out to Iowa City, I it was really hard because there were no galleries, there was no art museum. So I did end up going to the art museum, but Lloyd and I, we formed a chapter of the aggressive school of cultural workers, and because we didn't think the museum was a vigorous enough in its celebration or commemoration of December the 1st, Day Without Art, we locked it up and issued a manifesto. So the dance goes on. Thanks. That's it.